Hello and welcome to the Berks History Center's monthly program on BCTV. My name is Vicky Heffner and I'm the Education Curator at the Berks History Center. I'm happy to announce that I'm here with Brian Engelhardt, Trustee of the Berks History Center. And it's time to play ball, right?
There you go.
So in a most recent review of spring of 2021, Brian wrote an article on Eddie Day, A Career in the Shadows, and he's here today to tell us about that.
Thank you, Vicky. Why, Eddie Day was known as the Black Delahanty. There was an article subject of an article I wrote a year ago. Eddie Day's been a subject of my interest for a number of years. And the sporting life, which was the Bible of baseball around the turn of the century and became eventually the Sporting News, wrote an article where it referred to Eddie Day, the Black Delahanty. And it said in the article that he's not signed with any club, but he's working out in his hometown of Reading. He would have been in the National League a long time ago with his great hitting and great fielding, except for the color rule. And that's where we get to, that's why Eddie Day, it's a big secret. We played 130 years ago, one of the finest baseball players apparently to come out of Reading. Carl Fiorillo, Whitey Karowski, people remember, heard about that. Eddie Day, it's been a big secret. So let's talk about Eddie Day. He was born in 1874. He's a Reading native. His parents were William Day and Margaret Steele. His parents were originally from Virginia and moved to Reading. One of the challenges in putting this together, and as I say, when the era back then, I call when dinosaurs roamed the baseball paths, newspaper accounts of games didn't have interviews. They oftentimes didn't even have the first names of the players. Very few statistics were compiled. That didn't happen until beginning of the 20th century. And so putting together articles there was no interview I've ever seen with Eddie Day in all the reading I've done about him. And so that's a challenge for historians in general and in this instance, and particularly with black players, because they didn't get coverage hardly at all in the white press. His earliest years, by 15, he was already playing on what was the Reading Crescents, were what was referred to in the paper as the colored team in Reading. But he either batted cleanup, which is a very important in baseball, or leadoff. So he was amongst it was an adult team, but at age 15, he was holding his own with the grown-ups. Let's take a step back. We talked about the colored team. In 1887, major league owners entered into what was called a gentleman's agreement, unwritten, but basically it said we will not have any black players in the major leagues. There were only a few black players at that time, and they were excluded quickly, the minor leagues continued to have integrated teams in their own way. The teams, in some instances, were integrated, but more frequently, there were leagues where there was white teams and a black team or two. And as baseball historian Merle Kleinknecht said, apparently the players were perfectly happy to play against black players, but didn't want to have them as teammates. That was a sad situation at the time. Summed up in Baseball Encyclopedia, participants in all black leagues were destined to spend their careers in the shadows of relative obscurity. So you had Eddie Day spending his career in the shadows. However, notwithstanding the gentleman's agreement, the Reading Actives, who were a white team, brought Eddie Day along and allowed him or invited him to play for them. And he was quite a success. The Eagle said at the home opener, first off, they noted the stands were packed. And it said, quote, one day the colored third baseman on the home club made a play or appeared at the bat. He was cheered, and whenever he made an error, no fault was found by the fans. He was very much a leader in the 11-6 victory, and he threw six innings in relief against Pottstown. So he did it on the field, he did it on the mound. He was quite successful out of the get-go. Oops. The owner of the Actives, I'll just say, was a fellow, William Abbott. I call him Lucky Bill Whitman. He kept trying to do things, and he had problems. He ran for mayor four times unsuccessfully. He's noted as the fellow that built the pagoda as a recreational hotel up on top of Mount Penn, but he never operated it. He lost it because he never got a recreation license. He lost it basically through foreclosure. And so that failed. He started the United Baseball League in 1912. Well, that went broke. Baseball players were filing claims against him in his bankruptcy. And when he ran for mayor, he usually didn't do so well. He failed to carry a single ward in one of his operations. But he was the owner. So early on, one of the few tough times Eddie had with the team pitching, he gave 15 walks up to the Philadelphia Athletic Club, which wasn't the Philadelphia Athletics, the pro team. It was a club comprised of fellows that used to play for the Athletics. But in any event, he still had the victory. And with this victory, even after the 15 walks, 14-10, the Actives were 10-0. With Eddie Day leading the way. And coming into town on Decoration Day coming up that was what they called Memorial Day back then, were the Philadelphia Keystones, which were a very successful club team in Philadelphia for a day-night doubleheader. And this is the beginning of problems with Eddie and the team. First off, the Keystones didn't show up for the morning game. So Bill Whitman had to give out rain checks to every, he had both games, advance tickets were totally sold, and he had to give out rain checks to people for the morning game, which means they were gonna get to come to a later game for free. He was gonna keep the money for, but the rain checks so he wasn't gonna make money on the second game. Then he gets word that the Keystones aren't coming in the afternoon either, the afternoon train from Philly. And he thinks, I don't want to give more rain checks out. What am I going to do? So he says, I know. He contacts the Hillsides, which was a local club team. He said, hey, Hillsiders, it's Memorial Day. Want to play some baseball against the Actives? Well, some of the Hillsiders said, yeah, sure, okay, fine. And so Whitman thought, well, people will be happy to not get a rain check, and at least they'll see some baseball. And he was going to use some of the actives with the Hillsides to have enough people on the team. What's not to like? And he wouldn't have to refund any tickets or rain checks. Well, what was not to like was if you were Eddie Day and you've been pitching your arm off, and after the first inning, where the actives batted first, that the home team not batting first or batting last didn't come about as a set rule until 1950. But anyway, the actives batted first, so the team is going to go to the position. And Eddie Day went to center field and sat on the grass. And Whitman comes out and says, "No, you're going to pitch." He says, "No, I'm not going to pitch." And Whitman pursues him. And eventually Eddie Day goes and sits in the stands and folds his arms and says, "No, I'm not pitching. This is an exhibition game. I'm tired. I want to rest my arm. When we have a real game, we'll do that." Well, ultimately, Day agrees to play second base. Another member of the actives agrees to pitch. The team gives up 11 runs in the top of the bottom of the first inning to the Hillsides. Most of the fans leave at that point, and Eddie Day is fired for insubordination. Whitman releases him from the team for insubordination. Well, the Reading Times the next day said, "Really, insubordination?" And I'm not going to read this whole thing, but it's up there on your screen if you want to freeze this and read it. It's fascinating. Anyway, they said, "This was just an exhibition game. Eddie Day's been pitching his arm off. He's done great. He's pitched 2 15-inning games, and you're running him off the team for not pitching in this game?" Well, all that having been said, the next day, the New York Gorhams come in, which is was a black team that Barnstorm toured. And they had a Hall of Fame up-the-middle combination. King Solomon Saul White was at second base, and Frank Grant was at shortstop, two Negro leaguers that were eventually inducted into the Hall of Fame. And they cleaned the clock of the actives, 10-1. Well, that didn't go so well. So the next day, they're losing to Pottstown. Ultimately, they would lose the game. And during the game, Whitman is confronted by a group of prominent citizens with a petition signed by 150 lawyers and prominent, businessmen that says, "Bring back Eddie. Please bring back Eddie. Your team isn't doing so well without him." And so ultimately he agrees to bring Eddie back as long as Eddie signs an agreement that says, "I will listen to manager Whitman." All right. So Eddie's back. Back in the box, it says. And they win the game. Eddie would have had a shutout if his team hadn't made 3 or 4 errors. So is everything rosy again? No, maybe. The next day, the next game, Eddie doesn't pitch so well. Over the next 2 weeks, as a matter of fact, except for the game when he came back and almost threw the shutout, Eddie and the team, they go 5-4-1, and Eddie doesn't have any more victories as a pitcher during that time. He has a couple losses. And suddenly the Reading Times is saying, "This guy's a freak, and if manager Whitman wants to have any reasons further to release Eddie Day, all he has to do is look at his recent performance on the field." So, that's exactly what he did. And the one aspect also that was he was criticized for. It said no catcher wants to catch Eddie Day because he doesn't listen to any, he doesn't pay attention to their signals. He, when they say throw up here, he throws low. When they, anyway, and so the catchers are getting beaten up. They're not happy about that. So he lets them go. Well, a beginning of a baseball odyssey that would last another 15 years starts. Eddie leaves Reading and he signs with the original Cuban Giants. Who were the Cuban Giants? Well, the white press, when they would talk about black teams, they would call them Cubans. And there was lots of Cuban Giant teams. There was the Cuban Giants of York, Cuban Giants of Babylon, New York. Originally, the Ansonia Hotel Argyle Hotel, I'm sorry, up in Babylon, New York, had used its waiters who were black and most of whom were skilled baseball players to play games with teams to entertain their guests. And so that was the original Cuban Giants, and then they traveled. But as I said, there was several Cuban Giant teams around the country, and Eddie was playing with the original ones. 1892, he comes back to Reading. Now he's playing for the New York Gorhams. And here is the frustrating situation of compiling narratives of a baseball career back that time, particularly of a black player. They didn't always publish articles or scores or box scores regarding games that were involved in. However, occasionally when they did, that's where we got our information. Eddie comes back with the Gorhams against Reading, and they do well. On the Gorhams is George Stovey, who was also in the Hall of Fame. Eddie drives in the winning run as a first baseman on that Gorham team in the first game. In the second game, the Gorhams also win. Then he pops up later on umpiring a game where in Reading, in the middle of a month, he's not playing with any team. He's umpiring a game, gets in a fight as the umpire with a guy named Harry Shadow Pyle, a former pro player who said Eddie was calling the game wrong. So that was just an odd situation. Eddie's career was kind of tough to follow. In 1893, an article appears that he was arrested for assault. And so for about 2 years, there's nothing about Eddie Day in the paper. He failed to finish bail. Until 1897, he pops up playing for the Cuban Giants again. Then he pops up playing for the Reading Browns, which is a local team that was white, predominantly white. One of the things that were said during the partial integration of white teams occasionally by black players was a phenomenon during that time that was very hard to follow. But so Eddie pops up in 1897 in that respect. In 1898, he is the captain and the star of the Celeron Acme Colored Giants, which this is the last league where there were white teams and a black team. It was the Iron and Oil League up in northern Pennsylvania and New York. And unfortunately, the team had quite a stable of good black players that they signed, but they went 8-42 and disbanded a couple of weeks into the season. The league disbanded a week later. But Eddie then moved on. Who was the white Delahanty is a question. You say, why did they call him the black Delahanty? articles about the Celeron Giants that appeared nationally would say, and they have the black Delahanty, Eddie Day. White Delahanty was Ed Delahanty, who played 15 years for the Phillies, the Senators, and was probably the finest baseball player in the game in the White Leagues. And he met his demise, unfortunately, in 1903. He was put off a train because he was drunk. And it was near the Niagara River. And he walked on a trestle and either fell or jumped to his death in the Niagara River. But anyway, that's the White Delahanty's untimely demise. Eddie was a traveling man. He was reported to sign with the Chicago Unions and with the Baltimore Giants. I did not see box scores in any papers with his name in, but there were reports that those were teams that he was playing for. He was back in Reading with the Cuban Giants in 1903, pitching and hitting his way into local fans who cheered for him. The paper noted that he was a local fellow, a native, back in town playing in front of the home folks. The Cuban Giants of 1903, that's and there's Eddie is to, he is, I guess, your left of in the back row. 1904, he's with the Cuban ex-Giants. Those are fellows that used to play for the Cuban Giants, but now they're ex-Giants, and they played for that team, too. He was moving around. As I said, it was a baseball odyssey. Eddie's, near the end of his career, he was involved in a story of love in prison. There was a fellow named Harry Batchelder, who was a big star football player at Yale. Yale's down playing Princeton. May Cassidy of Reading is a young woman, and her girlfriend says, let's go down and watch these football players. And they go, okay. She says, okay, I'll check that out. And there's Harry Batchelder winning the game for Yale. He's their number one player. He was the center for some reason. He was flamboyant as they played football at that time. And at the end, he carries May Cassidy off the field because he was so happy, and she had rushed on the field with all the fans. And needless to say, they're married in a couple of weeks. Nobody is happy in either family. May begins, she wants to continue Harry's law career. In her office, she embezzles money. She's caught. She's arrested. So Harry needs to get money in order to get May off the hook with what she embezzled, reimbursed. So he becomes a manager of a cigar store. This is sounding like an O. Henry story. He hires Eddie to help him at the cigar store to run a poker game in the basement, because that's how you really make money at a cigar store. The authorities get onto it. Eddie's arrested, Batchelder's arrested, but May gets off the hook. They come up with money. Harry serves 6 months. Eddie serves 30 days, and the Batchelders leave Reading, much like Will Kane and Gary Cooper and Grace Kelly at the end of High Noon, riding off into the sunset for their future life. Nobody knows where they went. Sadly, Eddie dies at age 32 in 1906. He's buried. He had a heart condition. Medical science at that time could not help him. He was in the hospital 3 weeks. He's buried at Charles Evans Cemetery. And he was noted, his passing was noted throughout Pennsylvania as he was quite a figure in baseball locally. Last thing. There was an Eddie Day that played for the Philadelphia Giants, but it wasn't our Eddie Day, although it was reported to be Eddie Day. The fellow on the left isn't certainly the fellow in the middle or on the right who are the real Eddie Day. What was the Eddie Day imposter really all about? And that question I have no answer to. It's a sad story that it would take almost a half a century till finally the color line in baseball was broken, and until baseball was really integrated, it would take longer than that. But Eddie Day is a big local secret, and his skill, even as much as the accounts say he was as good as the best player in the white leagues, there's so little to go on as far as trying to quantify how good he was, nor was there any interview. So I'm glad to at least bring the story of Eddie to the readers and to now the audience here.
Well, thank you, Brian, very much for joining us on the Berks History Center's TV program. I think it interesting, Brian, that you often do this. You mentioned this was 130 years in the past, but you often take stories like this, write articles, do programs, but you also speak in Cooperstown often, correct?
Not often. Just when they, I'm actually going to be making this presentation at the end of this month to the 19th century. There's a 19th century committee of the Society of American Baseball Research. They have an annual program, and I will be making this presentation to the folks there. This was one of the presentations they thought was worth listening to.
Well, again, thank you for joining us, and visit the Berks History Center. We're open Wednesday through Saturday, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., and we'd love to see you. Bye-bye. What an interesting...